Hey guys, thank you so much for tuning in today. First of all, I just want to thank you so much for all your comments. Please keep them coming since it really encourages me to make more of these videos. I also want to help you guys learn as much as you can, so I've actually created a dedicated Facebook page where you can post your work or post any questions you might have for the community to answer. We're all on this XR journey together, so please like and subscribe and join our Facebook page so we can continue to make cool shit together. Anyway, here's your video. Today, we're going to learn about cursors and how you can use them to help your users interact with your application. First of all, let's start by defining what a cursor is and how it works in VR. I have my code set up already, and I've actually already added a really basic cursor to it. So now, if you move it around, I want you to notice something here. I want you to notice that this cursor, this mouse, is different to this A-frame cursor. You have to remember that the reason why there's two cursors currently is because we are developing this code, looking at it on the PC. In reality, when you're using this application and you've got VR goggles on, suddenly there is no mouse cursor. You have to consider the fact that we're working in a VR space at the moment. So whatever the cursor is, it has to simulate the way that we look at things in real life. Notice that when you move the cursor up, the angle of the scene changes rather than the cursor moving. Basically, it's similar to how when you want to look up, you tilt your head upward. That was a little bit of a ramble, but hopefully that makes a bit of sense. Remember how there's always two ways of writing an entity in A-frame. The first way is to use primitives. So for example, A camera and A cursors are primitives because they're basically something that's ready to go without us having to add additional components. The second way is to essentially rebuild the primitive using A entity and filling it up with the relevant components inside it to make it work just like the primitive does. The first thing I actually want to do with the cursor is to change the way that it looks. So at the moment, it's a circle and I want to change it to a square. Because a cursor is already built, basically pre-packaged, ready off the shelf, we need to rebuild this using a entity. So I'm gonna replace this with a entity, and then I am simply going to add a cursor component to it. But wait, why isn't anything showing up yet? It should just be off the shelf, right? Well, the thing about using an A entity is we have to decide what it looks like. So I am going to add a geometry. I'm going to make the primitive as box, give it a width. Oops, forgot the semicolon. Width, I'm going to make it 0.1. Width, height, same thing. And depth, 0.1. Great. And then I'm going to give it a color. Color, I'm going to make it green. And I am going to automatically format this since it's getting a bit long. Then I'm going to give it a position. So I think at the moment it's right on the camera at 000, which is what we don't want because we want to be able to actually see it, right? Chuck it on 00. Let's make it -2. Okay, so I've made a syntax error there, which is why the box is so massive. So I'm gonna change that to that, and there we go. That's exactly what I was expecting. And let's change this back to -2 so there's some space from the box and from the cursor itself. Now, this cursor can actually be used as an event trigger, which is primarily what a cursor is for, right? So let's give that a go. We are going to make this box spin when we click on it using the A-frame cursor. How are we going to do that? Well, the first thing we're going to do is we need to install the animation library and the script tags. So I'm going to copy and paste the script from my other screen. And then to this blue box, I am going to add an animation. Like, so we want it to rotate. Rotation from 0 degrees on each axis to 360 degrees on the Y axis. And then we're gonna say the duration is 2000 milliseconds, which is 2 seconds. Event, click. It's not properties, it's meant to be property. All right, there we go. Yes, got it. So
if I move the cursor out and I click, nothing happens, but as soon as I point it at the box and then click, it spins like we expect. But what if we don't have a device to click with? What if you're on the web with a Google Cardboard? How would you then click on things? That's where gaze-based controls come in. It basically means you can select something just by looking at it. But then there's another problem. How can Aframe tell you want to select it? I mean, because if you think about it, you could just be looking at it. There's another part of gaze-based controls called fusing. It allows you to specify a time which the user has to stare at something before it's considered to be a click. Here's how you do it. You have to initialize the cursor component so it contains a fuse. Let's fuse, and I'm gonna set this to true because we're gonna use fusing now. And then I'm gonna set a fuse timeout value. Alright, so now I'm going to take this out, put it back in, 1, 2, there we go. And that, my friends, is fusing for you. Alright, now let's take this to another level, because if you're a user and you're trying to play with something like this, you don't know when something's fusing or not, and it gets kind of annoying. So we're gonna make the cursor shrink when it's fusing, and then go back to its original size when it leaves the box. Let's do that now. I'm gonna move this out, and then I'm gonna add an animation property from its original size, and I'm gonna wanna make it shrink to events fusing. Righty ho. Yep, there we go. You can see every time it fuses, it shrinks. So let's add another animation here. Animation. Okay. Property scale 2, 1, 1, because we want it to go back to its original scale. And start events. Mouse leave. So now, if we try it out, you can see that it smoothly transitions out, and when it starts fusing, then it starts spinning around. And there we go. So far, it's been pretty easy because we're only working with one object, right? But in reality, you're probably going to have hundreds and hundreds of entities to work with. So then using this gaze-based interaction suddenly becomes really inefficient, because every time you make a click, Aframe actually checks every single clickable object to see which ones have been affected by the cursor. So the solution really is to make only some objects clickable. So to fix this problem, Aframe has something called a Raycaster. So what it does is it points a metaphorical ray of light towards where you click, and it only checks that general area instead of the entire scene. So pretty much what we've done is we've added two more boxes, so we have a row of three that when you hover over it, it should just fuse and then start spinning like this. All right, so this is just testing out to see that that's true. Great. So now we only want one of the box's animations to get triggered, because we want to show that we can make some objects clickable and some objects not. Notice that the start events are still here. So I'm going to add the Raycaster component. And then within that component is a property. And the property is called objects. This is where you specify which objects are clickable or not using their class or ID. So like usual, a class has a dot at the front of it and an ID uses a hashtag. And in this example, we're going to use a class, and I'm going to call it clickable. Okay. So now we need to just take this class and apply it to the shape. Oops, I've made a syntax error there. So now that it's reloaded, you can see that the cursor isn't shrinking and the blue box isn't spinning around at all. If I point it to the yellow, nothing happens. But if I point it to the red, it starts fusing. So that's when you know that it works. Hopefully you learned something in this lesson. I'll leave it up to you now to absorb all that information, and I'll see you in the next one.
Hey guys, just a quick update. I've been super, super busy pivoting my business to focus more on AR and VR. There's gonna be a lot of new stuff coming, so please hit subscribe, like, and hit the notification bell so you can stay updated. Building the XR community on this channel really means a lot to me and brings me a lot of joy. So thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you next time.